in mathematical logic, which he was doing in Amsterdam, and I'm doing logic in Munich. What's interesting, by the way, is that you say in your bio you say it's mathematical logic.
Yes.
But is what in the computer science department?
No, it's in an institute called Institute for Logic, Language, and Computation.
Ah, okay. Because so in Uni, most of the logic happens in computer science, not in mathematics, which is kind of strange, but it's the way it is.
Yeah,
the talk is going to be about combining Spark and Shapeless, and I personally don't know anything about Spark, but I know that it's a very hot library in Scala. Is it still the case?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. So, and of course we had the type level summit, so there must be Shapeless.
Okay,
please have a warm welcome.
Thank you all. Thank you for attending the talk. Yes, I did have some background in logic. So I learned lambda calculus and category theory in my master. But still, top level things are still hard to me. So that's why in this talk I want to make it accessible to everyone, so I don't assume any background from you. But just to get familiar with your background, by a quick show of hands, who uses Spark? Ah, cool. One third or quarter? Who used the MapReduce? Ah, good. I think we have half the audience familiar with big data. I currently work as a data scientist and a data engineer at a startup in Amsterdam. The name of the company is Connectera. So we make smart devices to put on dairy cows, and we generate insights from the sensor data, and we provide farmers actionable insights. So the whole company actually is on top of data. Our core business is modeling and provide predictions. So that's why big data and IoT is a fundamental part of our daily job. ETL, who don't know what ETL stands for? Okay, good. So ETL is not new. It came from the database community, I think. E stands for data extraction, T stands for data transformation, and L stands for data load or loading. Today I'm focusing on E and T, so I'll skip the load part. The reason that I bothered with learning top level, is to solve a concrete problem from our business. So, because the things with data science is that we need a lot of feature engineer or engineering. For each data science project, probably we need at least 5 or 6 features. Even with a very simple raw data schema, you can easily make maybe 4 or 5 different features from simple raw data. And that's why we need a library, which enables flexible feature engineering work. So why we use Spark? For those who don't know what Spark is, it's a framework that enables you to perform data processing on a cluster, so on multiple nodes, in a management way. It will hide all the distributed runtime details from you. So the reason we picked Spark is that we want to implement our own distributed algorithms to make efficient data transformation. And we did some benchmarking. So as you can see in the graph, we tested against the Spark RDD API. Spark Data Frame API and Spark Dataset API, and also Flink Dataset API. This job is to produce kind of clustering of one type of activity. You can think of a user activity. I'll show you later what these use cases. But the performance shows that Spark RDD gives us the best performance. The reason why the Spark dataset has such bad performance is that it doesn't offer this map set reduce in the API. So when we code our algorithm in Spark dataset, it translates into multiple passes of global sorting, so which is really bad. So one thing you want to avoid in big data ETL is global sort, because it's always a performance killer. Map set reduce means that you want to pre-aggregate your data before your reduce phase, because reduce is where the data shuffling happens. That's why we decided to use Spark RDD. Why did I bother with the dev level? The reason is that, so I'm a terrible typer. I made all kinds of typos. So I want a spider, I want a compiler to help me catch all the typos. That's really one of my earliest motivation to do things on the type level. And I also want to use tools like type classes to improve the composability of our code, which I will elaborate more on. And we want to build libraries which is easy to extend by users without recompiling the whole code base. So let me show you a simple use case. So here we have this raw data type coded in this case class. So we have user ID, we have activity type, and timestamp of the event, meaning at which point the event happens. And we have duration, recording time. So you can think of this as monitoring data for maybe a Fitbit, if you wear any Fitbit. We try to aggregate it. And what typical in data science is that different different values of certain field may code different processing semantics. So that here we have sitting result and the walking result, but the process logic differs slightly. So what you can do, this is the dumbest thing you can do, right? You can define two different functions and you let the users pass the right data input to it. Of course, you can do it in a smarter way. For example, you can still provide the user one function and let the users pass the string value, so that inside your function you can do pattern matching. And of course, you need to safeguard against the user providing the wrong value or values that you haven't considered. So I don't like this very much, because when you have 10 or 20 fields or values in certain fields and you hard code all the significant values, then there are a lot of opportunities to make typos without user being aware of it. Or if you, as a library provider, if you're not careful safeguarding this, you can easily give runtime errors or worse, to provide result which doesn't make sense. Would it be nice if we can provide a type of sitting and walking and let the compilers find the right implementations of the specific logic for us? But this is what I want. So what we can do is to start using sitting types. This is the way I learned how to use sitting types with shapeless. Maybe there are better ways. I think in the morning we saw like a literal kind of translation, right? Directly use literals, and then the shapeless can give you a type. But this is the way I commonly use, and also gives you the feeling that this is a real type, so this is not valid. I think this is beneficial. So how we can use it? So we can code it like very simple type class? Okay. Seems I'm running out of time. So I hope like at least I can introduce you how to make a type class. So who don't know what a type class is? Okay. So I don't want to lose anyone. So type class is just, in my view, it's a better Java interface. So it just you provide an abstraction, and you can code against this abstraction. Then the users can provide instantiations of your abstraction, so they can get your higher stuff for free. So this is why we use type class. So here, I have this aggregator. So this abstraction hide implementations of several functions. So extract, aggregate, aggregation is just internally how your process transform data. So what you normally do is to provide some default implementations of for common data types. But here you can see I have this type A, which is subtype of string. So namely, I use the singleton types. So inside of extract function, you use the Spark API. You do the filter. You get the, for example, name gets you back the value of the singleton type. Then you can do filter on it. Then do your transformation. So what you get? So if you don't want to use this this particular default instance derivation, you can provide your own ones. So for example, here the return type is slightly different, right? Because now I aggregate not only the duration, but I also added the count. So you can see the dot map now gives you one, so which is used for aggregating the count. So now there's another shapeless trick. So once you import the monad syntax, you get a monoid for free. So I have a link to an online tutorial. You can find the details there later. So the nice thing about shapeless is that it gives you a natural, like a for free translation from your type classes to HList representations and get all the monoid implementations. So this is how you can use it. The downside of this one is that you get the kind of a polymorphism, but now it's not composable because the return type is not really obvious for the user. But there's a higher like abstracted version, so which is available on this link. I think my time is out. Yeah, okay, I'll maybe use the 2 minutes to show you what we were able to achieve. For example, currently like a lot of our production jobs uses code of this style. So this is how you get like your default implementation of certain type classes. You just call it utility this, and then what we do is we don't. So we use the types to summon the processing logics. So we don't search the right functions to call. We just say, I want this. So this is the type I want to your library to return me. And now you just call this this kind of helper object to get you this return type. I'm sure there are better ways to hide even this kind of details from the user, but I currently don't know how. But the flavor is that we use types as guidance. So we had the dependency details from the user. We like the compilers to find the right instance or implementations of the logic. So what's under the hood is all kinds of type classes. So for example, this one. This is not only for singleton types. Once the user can prove that your implementation of A is, this is a default way to get back your type class instantiation. If you don't like it, you just provide your instantiations. So it makes your code composable in the sense that you can always build things on a higher level. And the users can plug in on the lower level, so they get the higher level for free. So this is another thing we can do. So let me quickly go through the cons. So because I work as a data scientist, well, not every data scientist cares about types. So I think, yeah, you do need to let the users use your library. You need, you require them to appreciate types and maybe compiler errors. Because I personally use compiler errors as a guidance to get the right things. There's also danger of ambiguity. If you have a lot of logics that you need in one job, having the same input type, output type, then if you're not careful, you mess up all the right implementations of your logic. Yeah, that's my talk. Yeah, thank you all.
I think we have time for one or two quick questions.
Can we go back to the first slide where you showed, sort of what, I think the title was What We Achieved. It was the first example. It was a really nice short example. I think,
where was this one?
Yes, that's it. Can I just clarify my understanding of what you've done here? Mm-hmm. So am I right that basically the type of sitting eating result, mm-hmm. so and critically the pair key simple aggregation, effectively the user, as it were, is specifying that type as saying this is the type of thing I want.
Yeah.
Given the input RDD, which has some,
yes.
and essentially your mechanics are allowing you to infer the entire extraction aggregation,
exactly.
process.
Yeah. Oh,
that's very nice.
Yeah.
That's nicely done.
If you
done.
Go to this slide, so there's a cache, I think somewhere on this one. Do you see an implicit map? Sorry.
I guess it was just kind of the headline thing there, because I mean this relates to what Andrea was talking about in her talk. This is kind of multi-paradigm programming. You just embedded a nice bit of logic programming effectively.
Yes.
In using implicit resolution and that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
That's pretty
exactly.
cool. I like that. Very nice.
Yeah. Thank you.
Okay, so let's thank the speaker.